Well, good morning and welcome to Blackburn Presbyterian Church. We're viewing from our various homes and lounge rooms, but we're joining together through the Word of God and through the turbulent times in which we're living when our domestic routines are dramatically changed. We're praying together and learning this morning as we look at a further study in the Lord's Sermon on the Mount. Can I invite you to join with us in prayer from the start? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we remember that on Palm Sunday, you rode into Jerusalem, serving your Heavenly Father and bringing healing and health to the wayward world. Today, the advent of COVID-19 has brought fresh turmoil, new dangers and grief to your human family. In this short time together, strengthen us by your Holy Spirit. Draw us near through your word and renew your image in us. So may we be careful to offer you the praise and the glory due to your name by heartfelt worship and devoted service. Amen. Now we're working from the Sermon on the Mount, which begins with the Beatitudes. And we are making it our custom to read the Beatitudes together to remind us of the character of the people that Jesus is speaking to and calling to follow him. So we're going to read Matthew 5, verses 1 to 10, together once again. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Now, normally we have a short segment called Young at Heart. And I thought today, while people are cooped up at home and wondering what they might do, if we could take a leaf out of Colin Buchanan's book. I noticed that through the week, that from his home, wherever his home is, Colin Buchanan did a concert, a live performance, in which he entertained us from his iPhone as he moved it from inside to outside and sang familiar songs for children and for adults to join in. So I thought we might just look at the words of one of these. This is one that particularly caught my eye because we've come to that part of the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus is talking about prayer. And this little song, "You Can Tell the Lord That You Love Him Anytime," caught my eye. You can tell the Lord that you need him anytime. Thank him for his love and care. Shoot him up an arrow prayer. You can tell the Lord that you love him anytime. So this was a catchy little song that Colin sang through the week. And I thought it might be worth mentioning to you that prayer is something that children are invited to participate in. And indeed, our children, when they come to parents with requests, in a sense, are making their prayer to their parents. And parents, in their wisdom, have to judge between what a child needs and what a child wants and what that might imply for siblings and so on, and grant the petition of the child's prayer or not. But one of the things I thought it might be good for all parents to think about while they're at home is Colin has got a book of songs, Colin's big music book, as you can see. And it might be just one of those things that during this time of isolation at home, you pick up a musical instrument or go to a keyboard and just join in singing. There's some beautiful things come out of creative musicians joining together across the internet to sing. And it's a good opportunity to try and invest in singing and making music, especially to God in our homes. So think about Colin's concert and have a look on YouTube. You'll find a lot of his videos there, and hopefully they're inspiring you the way they inspired me when I watched him during the week. Now I'm going to ask Christine to read to us the passage from the Sermon on the Mount that we're looking at today. Thank you, Christine.
Good morning, again, empty chairs. And after the service, Graham's going to climb on one of those empty chairs. This is for Blackburn Presbyterian Church people. It won't mean so much to anyone else's viewing, but we're very glad that you're viewing with us. We've loved the messages that have come in through the week. But he's going to climb up and turn the clock back. And boys, I hope we're all together in church before we have to change the clock again. So also, I should mention, if any children are watching, that Graham was going to play that song for you this morning, but then he thought perhaps there were some copyright issues. But there's lots of those songs, as Graham said, on YouTube. So now to the reading. Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 to 15. I'm reading from the New International Version, and this whole section is entitled Prayer. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. May God bless this reading of his word. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you, Christine. Well, I've used this image, this familiar image of Albrecht Dürer's praying hands, dated from 1508, as the image to convey the notion of prayer as we think about it this morning. Jesus has come to that point in the sermon where he's teaching his disciples about prayer. And I should say that if you're viewing and you'd like a copy of the sermon notes, they are available to download, and they will be put on the web page in time. But if you want to email me, I'm happy to send you a copy. There's a summary of the sermon in here. That means that if you switch off now, you can come back and look at it. But I want to just take us a little bit into the mind of Jesus. And so today's sermon is called learning to pray like Jesus. Learning to pray like Jesus. And the passage that Christine has read, I read again from the Message version, Eugene Peterson's translation of the New Testament. And I've taken the headings from that translation, broadly speaking. So the first of those headings is this, that the question is, are we putting on a performance? He uses that word. So is prayer a performance? The second thing is he talks about finding a quiet, secluded place. Go into your room, Eugene Peterson calls it. Find a quiet, secluded place. And then we're asking the question, are we trying to get what we can from God? Is that the idea in prayer, or is that something that needs to be corrected? So that's an important question to ask. And then we have Jesus saying, it's your Father that you're coming to. And this, I would suggest, is what changes everything as Jesus brings us to prayer. And then finally, I want to say something about he knows what you need. So these are the headings, and I'm going to just take us through them in order. First of all then, are we putting on a performance? This whole section deals with the idea of our good deeds, which we looked at last week, our almsgiving, our concern for other people. And Jesus says, are you making a show of that? Now he's talking about prayer. And he's asking us, is that a performance? And in a couple of weeks' time, we'll be looking at what he says about fasting. And he asks this question, is it a performance? Is it to be seen by men? So when we think about putting on a performance, what does that mean? Well, there's no doubt that prayer is in the news. Google searches for prayer skyrocket amid coronavirus outbreak, is a report. The number of searches on Google for the word prayer have greatly increased over the past few weeks as the coronavirus has garnered headlines, according to a research paper from the University of Copenhagen. That paper goes on to say this. The man who was behind it, Benson, analyzed internet searches for prayer from 75 countries and reported that search intensity for prayer doubles for every 80,000 new registered cases of COVID-19. So a dramatic rise in prayer. And in our own media, it's been dramatically spoken of this week. In fact, I'm going to ask Christine just to, she's brought with her a clip from yesterday's paper, which I'm going to ask her to read to you. Thank you, Christine.
Yes, most of the Australians who are tuning in will know that last week, same work, start of another week, our Prime Minister, someone had made a clip of him talking and praying with a private coronavirus prayer group. And he wasn't praying as Prime Minister, he was praying as a private Christian, who is also our Prime Minister. And yesterday in Melbourne's Age, which is, well, most of you know the name, Melbourne paper, Julia Baird, who is one of our well-known TV journalists, but also one of our writers, had an article entitled, Morrison Will Pray, Let Him. And I thought, oh, I didn't think Julia would be putting our Prime Minister down for praying at this time. She is doing the exact opposite. And she has told the minority of people who are to just get their act together, really. She says, as well as talking about what he is doing and how he is leading the country at this time, the Prime Minister is a genuine Christian who is open about his faith. She makes the point he's not using it for political gain. He is going to pray about everything, often. And then I found this very interesting. Even the renowned Prime Ministerial critic, Mike Carlton, was moved this week to remind Twitter that Morrison is shouldering a burden unmatched by any other Prime Minister. And then she goes on to say, we must remember that prayer is a non-partisan activity. In the US, for example, according to the Pew Research Center, which I hadn't heard of, the same number of Democrats and Republicans pray every day. So let's keep praying. And thank you, Julie.
Well, so prayer is in the news. And what stands out as Jesus teaches his disciples to pray is the idea of a quiet, secluded place. Now, not everybody can withdraw to a quiet and secluded place. But it's clear that Jesus did whenever he could. We have numerous times in the Gospels, it's recorded that he went apart to pray for a time. Now, this doesn't mean that Jesus says that prayer in public, prayer on the internet, prayer in a church service is not on. Far from it. But he's saying that the real test of prayer is when we're on our own. He encourages us to pray together. In next week's part two on prayer, we're going to hear him say, Our Father. So it's a corporate prayer that he has in mind. But right now he's saying the test of prayer is really what happens privately in the quietness of your own mind and room. There is a danger, you see. We need to guard against conning ourselves. We need to guard against empty phrases. What is prayer like? Well, sometimes it's in the very opposite of a quiet, secluded place. For example, when you're trekking in Nepal, you can't but help see prayer flags flying from all kinds of angles. Sometimes you've been perhaps in Europe and you've been in a cathedral and you've lit a candle, a prayer candle, because you're thinking of someone and you want, in a sense, that thought to linger and perhaps to inspire others. Or perhaps you've seen the prayer wheels in various Buddhist temples. I must say I was taken aback to see prayer wheels turned by a water wheel in a village which had no electricity. They had hydro energy turning their prayer wheels. And even recently I read about people who are praying to the ocean for forgiveness for the pollution that we've caused in the oceans. And I think this was particularly after the oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico. And the image that I've used, here's another one, an image of prayer from Islam. It's one of the dominant images of prayer. We see people prostrating themselves before God. And the one I've used for the reference to the research was this image of a girl praying quietly, and of course, Al-Rakdura's praying hands. So what are we to say about this? Well, interestingly enough, Eternity magazine had Nama's story. And in this story, this is the story of a young woman who was a refugee in northern Iraq, sought refuge in the hills with other Kurds, saw terrible things, fleeing refugees being shot from helicopter gunships. And eventually she was in a camp for people who were seeking refuge. And she saw somebody reading a Bible in Arabic. And this is what she said. Let's see if we can read it there on the screen. I'll underline the words. In Matthew 6, she started reading from Matthew's Gospel. She got as far as our text today, Matthew 6. And Matthew 6, Jesus said, when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who is unseen, sees what is done in secret and will reward you. And she says, it was true. I knew for the first time I could pray to God. It was amazing because as a Muslim girl, she'd seen prayer enacted so many times, but it never struck her that she could come to God herself without the set prayers and the ritual of a call to prayer five times a day. And so she started to pray the way Jesus does. But what does Jesus do when he prays? Is he trying to get what he can from God? Is it because we've got a list of things to ask about, sort of a shopping list? Well, I think there are two common misconceptions here, and I want to just bring them before you. The first is that prayer is about getting what you want from God. We come because we are in need and we want something. And there's no doubt that that's what's driving the spike at the moment. We have a felt need as a human family. Around the world, there is an unseen enemy, something that could be mortally dangerous. And so we're looking for help and some kind of rescue. That's one of the misconceptions, that prayer is just about getting what you want from God. And the second is, if we're good enough, God will grant our requests. This is the idea that God, it's sort of like a Santa Claus idea of God. If we're good, God will be persuaded, will twist his arm, or will camouflage the bad stuff we do, and we'll make him think of the good stuff. When I was thinking about this, I couldn't help thinking about Janis Joplin. Some of you may know she has a song, "Oh Lord, won't you give me a Mercedes-Benz? My friends all drive Porsches, I must make amends. Worked hard all my life." So here's the idea in Janis's song, tragic story of Janis, really, but here's the idea in her song, that she comes to God for cargo culture, really. God will give me something if I ask it and I'm working hard for it. So this is not the way prayer works. It's not the way we come to God. God has come to us. That's what Christmas was about. God is in pursuit of us. And we don't need to tell him how good we are or even how bad we are. We just need to come to him knowing that he loves us. And that's what Jesus is saying. This is your Father you've come to. So I want you to just think about that. The most powerful story, I think, in this category is Jesus' story of the prodigal son in Luke 15. I'm sure you know it. It's one of those stories that's made its way into Western culture. Jesus himself, of course, had that experience when he was baptized of hearing those words, "This is my beloved son. My beloved son." So here was Jesus, the Son of God, inviting us now to share that relationship. He invites us into the intimacy of that relationship. Through faith in Jesus, we're kind of connected to him. This is what baptism is about. You're baptized into Christ. So that Christ is kind of taking you on as one of his. And he's shaping you. We're children of God. We're adopted into God's family. We're invited to know God as our Father. The image of the prodigal son was something I was privileged to see a few years ago in St. Petersburg. This is Rembrandt's painting, famous painting, in the Hermitage in St. Petersburg. And the bedraggled son in Rembrandt's painting has returned to the wealthy home of his father. And the father has his hands on his son, embracing him. Son has fallen in humility before him. "Father, I've sinned. I'm not worthy to be called your son." So he came back with this changed attitude, realizing that his father knew what he needed. And that's exactly where Jesus takes us. Your heavenly father knows what you need. He knows your need. Just as parents know what children need. Now, Jesus prayed, and he knows our needs. I've just got an image here of one of the best-known American preachers, Rick Warren. Rick Warren is a Times bestseller author. His book, The Purpose-Driven Life, sold over 30 million copies. entirety of his life is embraced by God's purpose. And here's a quote from him: "There is a grand designer behind everything. Your life is not the result of random chance, fate, or luck. There is a master plan. History is his story. God is pulling the strings." Now, we're invited to believe that the God who's pulling the strings of history loves us. St. Paul tells us in chapter 30 of 1 Corinthians that we don't see that yet. It's obscured from our view. But we're invited to believe it by faith. And the challenges that we encounter in life's journey are going to mess with our faith and take it, hopefully, to new levels of potency and intimacy in our relationship with God. One of the stories that spoke to me some years back was the story of Terry Waite. Terry Waite was the special envoy of the Archbishop of Canterbury, Archbishop Brunson, back in the 80s, and he was going to Lebanon during the war there to negotiate the release of hostages. He'd done this several times successfully, but eventually he himself was taken hostage, and he was a prisoner for 1,764 days, and the first 4 years were in solitary confinement, and about a year of that was with a chain in a room that was just a few paces long and with the window boarded over with corrugated iron. You want to know what confinement's like? Well, we're all experiencing it, but this was extreme. And he tried to establish routines. He's a big man, he's 6'7", so over 2 meters tall. And for 10 minutes a day, he was allowed off a chain to go to the toilet. So a massive imposition on this man's life. Eventually, he was free. How did he cope with the solitude? He yearned for books to read. He introduced disciplines in his life, walking discipline in his cell, the discipline of prayer, and other reminiscences. And he wrote the book, Taken on Trust, in his head while he was in captivity. So here are people seeking God's way. Terry Waite now. But this is Palm Sunday. And I want to remind you that on Palm Sunday, the Jesus who is teaching us about prayer and about his heavenly Father himself rode into Jerusalem. He rode into the heart of the storm, as it were. He was seeking to love God and to love neighbor. And you would say, in terms of goodness, surely this man should have been protected from all harm. But it wasn't like that. He was stepping into the danger place for us. He was doing this to become the savior of the world. His intimacy with the Father took him to Jerusalem. And today we're conscious that many good people are taking themselves into danger to pursue the well-being of their neighbor and to honor their God. So as we continue in our service, we're going to pray. And I'm going to read the prayers. I have them on the screen behind me. Prayers of intercession and gratitude. And I'd like to invite you to follow them with me and to say the Lord's Prayer for me in particular as we come to the close. Let's pray. On Palm Sunday, Jesus journeyed to Jerusalem to fulfill his calling in his perfect and unflinching love for God and neighbor. He became the Savior of the world. As Christians, we seek to love God and our neighbor in his name. Please join us as we pray for God's heart of love, mercy, and truth to dwell in us and show us how to face the challenges of this time. Lord Jesus, during your ministry on earth, you healed people of all ages, from physical, mental, and spiritual ailments. Be present now to each person who needs your loving touch because of COVID-19. May they feel your power and healing through the care of doctors and nurses. Take away the fear, anxiety, and feelings of isolation, especially from people receiving treatment or under quarantine. Comfort all who grieve for absent loved ones, especially those who mourn for loved ones who died alone and whom they cannot farewell in the normal way. Lord, we pray for our Prime Minister and the National Cabinet as they guide the nation through this unprecedented time. May harmony and wisdom prevail. May help, support, and encouragement reach those who have lost employment, home, and income, as the resources of the Australian Taxation Office and Centrelink and all financial agencies play their part. Dear Lord, we lift to you our concern for people who are more likely than others to become severely ill, the elderly and people with chronic health conditions. Be their comfort in this time of uncertainty and isolation from loved ones. God, healthcare workers and first responders are working longer hours with fewer supplies and more risk of contracting COVID-19 themselves. Renew their energy and sustain them for long shifts. Protect them as they serve the needs of others. Bring healing by their devotion. Inspire and invigorate researchers to develop better tests which diagnose the virus, create vaccines and identify protocols to eliminate the spread of the disease. We pray that people all over the world will pull together to overcome this pandemic, that the cry of the poorer countries will be heard, that they will receive the help they so desperately need, and that humanity will prevail even in the war zones of the world. Lord, have mercy. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The final benediction. And now, may the grace of the Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit rest upon whoever views this and enters into its spirit. Lord, be with us now, and this week we pray for Christ's